Welcome back, and we're getting right back, fucking hot off the ass here.
Getting right backside with you.
Right back, Murray. That's beautiful. It's like poetry.
Hey.
Like surfer poetry.
Spiritual.
What's the best surf wax to use on your ass?
Carnova.
That's right.
You didn't think I had one, did you?
Yeah, my friend Carrie yelled at this point, "That butt! I'd know that asshole anywhere!"
I know that asshole anywhere. Wow.
Well, assholes are like fingerprints. Everyone has a different individual asshole.
So that's right.
That's true.
So Utah has fingered this guy's asshole. He knows exactly what he's looking at. He knows he's got himself a suspect. Not just any suspect.
Not suspect. He knows it in his gut. He's developing a gut.
He's developing a gut. The good gut bacteria. Usually you have to use years of, you know, good microbial yogurts and bullshit like that. Good fermentation.
Probiotics.
Yeah. He's got it. Jamie Lee Curtis got nothing on Johnny Utah.
She's the greatest mystery solver of our time. People don't know that about Jamie Lee Curtis.
She's got such good gut bacteria. She solves crime.
I would trust anything she said. I would just go, here's the facts. Tell me who did
it. I see. I hate it when people hear this part of the episode. They're like, why can't they just start like this every time? Why do we have to listen to life stories, Joel Coleman wrestling? Why can't we just have this?
I think about that sometimes. I'm like, is this keeping holding us back?
I mean, really, we started off with fingering buttholes, a butt.
What people
wax.
Want to hear. Yeah.
Yeah. Aabra, is this right? Are we?
We do seem to be. We do seem to go on a lot of, you know, side quests, but it's fun.
Okay. Side quests are fun, is what I heard. So keep the side quests. It gives us contrast to our episodes.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's right. All right, so Johnny's not going on a side quest, though. He's on his main fucking mission, unlike that new Tears of the Kingdom game where it's all side quests.
Okay. So he tails Bodhi and his crew. He's first of all, he's devastated. He doesn't want to believe this.
Well, what have we been talking about the whole first half of the movie? Let's just summarize that. Johnny Utah has daddy issues, became a quarterback, has always been the glorified quarterback of the world. He was a college quarterback. He was a Rose Bowl fucking glory boy.
He played at the Ohio State.
That's right. And now he's just an FBI lawyer. That's it.
Yeah.
No
loser,
attention.
Basically.
He's not on TV.
He's not like a cool surfer, dude. He's a fucking lawyer.
He was supposed
to be. Yeah, exactly. He's a goody two-shoes. He did what he was told. Never been himself.
He met bad boy Bodhi.
He sold out, as Pink Floyd would say, for the corporate whores.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so he's disillusioned. The smog is dissipating.
I like when you say because that's just surfer talk. You're just keeping in theme with the episode.
So he tails. He doesn't want to believe it, but he's like, I got to do my job. So he tails.
Right.
Tails him.
I like this. He's able to put feelings aside here for a moment because we know all those feelings, all that.
It's the only way he could survive. That's the only way he could stop him from being in the fetal position right now, crying.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Is just immerse yourself in work. So he comes back with what he learned from that tailing to Papa's. And he's like, they scoped out a bank.
Sure of it.
And look, he's like, look at the calendar. August, like, it's like almost Labor Day, which is the unofficial end of summer.
That's right.
And he's like, summer's almost over. We know that they always finish the summer with one last fucking bank robbery.
And Utah believed in Papa, so Papa is going to believe in you. His name is Papa's, for fuck's sake. It's Papa. Is he a daddy figure for him?
Yeah, Aabra pointed that out 3 hours ago. Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah. It's been a long time, Tim.
You mean 50-something hours ago, she pointed that out to me.
You've heard this before. I've said stuff, and literally 5 seconds later, Griff will repeat it. And I'm like, yeah, I just said that 5 seconds ago. Yeah, I know.
We do a hard thing here where we try to look over our notes and interpret what you're saying. So I'm just going to go ahead and give myself an out.
So they scope out that bank that the ex-presidents had scoped out.
Right. Johnny comes back with the information. Here's the bank they're scoping out straight out of the 60s. So, of course, Aabra's mom had the full breakdown of everything going on with this bank. Knew exactly where the cafeteria and the bathroom and the secret bathroom were. But
I got an idea, guys. How about you, me, Aabra, maybe Matford? I don't know. I'm not sure about him yet. And Aubra's mom rob a bank.
Oh, I'm there. What is
this? This is escalated.
The ex-prime ministers.
I just took a look at what you posted in our Discord here. Jesus, McGinley, yeah. Christ. Is this what you've been seeing this whole movie. I get it.
So they're staking it out. Pappas is engrossed in this new comic strip called Calvin and Hobbes.
Never heard of it.
So he's like, yeah. Calvin and Hobbes, this is great shit. And he's like, you know what? It's lunchtime. Why don't you give me some of them meatball sandwiches?
Pappas, it's 10:30.
My fucking film, I can't tell time. Go get them. This is the ultimate culmination. He's been following these guys for years. Yeah. And he's like, I can't, when I get a little rumble in my tummy, everything goes to hell.
Yeah, that's it. That's it for me. I gotta eat. Now, I do what my stomach tells me to do.
So he just buries his face in this Calvin and Hobbes.
And then, yeah, I'm glad you said buries his face, because this was a little too fucking on. I haven't seen this movie in probably 8 years, and that was only my first time when I saw it 8 years ago. I hope we're still on. My cat just walked across the keyboard. And so I was like, oh, that's right. Gary Busey was with them because of the way he holds up the newspaper and sends him out for meatball sandwiches?
Meatball sandwiches.
Sandwiches.
Two.
He calls Utah back two meatballs. I mean, there are Sixers, so you only get like four meatballs.
Fortunately, in L.A., there's a meatball sandwich stand on every corner.
Every corner.
And so it's just literally like across the street from the bank. He gets the orders. He's like, I want two meatball sandwiches and the driest tuna sandwich on whole wheat.
We talked about it last week. Whole wheat, dried out, just been sitting underneath, some kind of dry vent for the last week. Tuna that's been left out for a few days. No mayonnaise. Don't have anywhere fat near it. Anything fatty near it, rather. Right. Yeah. Worst sandwich
that's
ever.
That's weird because you think at this moment, he would have adopted Pappas' ways, and because this is a total harp sandwich.
Yeah.
And so it's like weird that he's still like, but some of his past is still lingering.
Yeah. Some of the past, we're at the midpoint. So you're getting the blend still, he was getting a little wild by getting the lemonade. Cause that's very sugary.
Yeah. It is.
And sugar.
I hope it isn't like that shitty, like country time where it's just like a powder. That's the worst. Powder. No.
What's your favorite beverage that's non-alcoholic, Aabra?
Oh, it's Lord.
Like, do they make it non-alcoholic?
Like, what a fascinating concept. Yeah, I probably drink more Diet Coke than I should.
Okay, Diet Coke.
I'm drinking a Coke Zero as we speak.
Murray's drinking a Coke Zero.
My girl. Yeah. So, he's engrossed in the sandwiches. Pappas is engrossed in Calvin and Hobbes. And meanwhile, a bank is being robbed.
Yep.
So Johnny turns around with the sandwiches in hand, and he sees the ex-presidents jump in their getaway.
He just
car.
Sees the car, and he's like, oh, did you notice that car?
That's running?
That's running right outside the bank. We're watching. And he's like, no, man. You see this joke, Calvin and Hobbes? He's riding a wagon down a hill. His tiger's not real, but
it's
real.
This shit's whimsical. I feel like a kid again.
I mean,
I hope they don't merchandise this shit.
How does Pappas have a job? He's the worst.
Because he gets shit done. Yes. All right? He's unorthodox, but he gets shit done.
I agree with that.
So then the ex-presidents run out. He's like, freeze, asshole! And like Johnny just starts shooting at the guys. They take off.
We get some windows shot out and everything. They're spooked a little bit here.
And we get a chase. Pappas jumps in the car. Pappas takes off.
Right. It's a car chase. Yeah. Is there anything notable of a car chase?
I like the practical effects, all of the squib work on the car, and when the windows blow, there are actual stuntmen in a moving car. I thought that was pretty good.
That was good. Yeah.
So Pappas crashes his car. So Johnny's got to hoof it.
They're going side to side with each other. Yeah. They're kind of tussling, and Pappas' car gets thrown into like a little ticket booth.
It's like a 1970s photo mat or some shit.
Yeah.
Crashes. We see, we know they crash because steam starts coming out of the front of the car.
So Johnny has to put his knee into full gear.
Right.
He's got to run them
he's
down.
He's a regular, I'm trying to think of a quarterback that runs a lot. I can't think of any right now.
Oh, Jesus.
He's the one, the dogfighting guy, because that'll play Vic. Into later on. Vic.
Yeah, Michael Vic.
Foreshadowing.
Patrick Mahomes.
So he starts running after the boys. Their car's fucked, too, and they need to get, they've already, they know what, they probably figured they're going to call the cops in, so they know what car they're in, so they have to get another car.
Right.
So they stop at a gas station. And this was an, I like, this was a cool scene.
This was a cool scene. This is a great scene.
Because Bodie, he's like MacGyver. He's just like, I can make that gasoline nozzle into a flamethrower. Yes.
I don't think you ever saw it, but Zoolander did a parody of this scene.
I did see that, where they're like playing around and covering each other.
Yeah. It's definitely not a parody of the scene, but yeah. I just thought of that scene just now.
And then, funny you bring that up, because Bodie also, because the guy like running the gas station is like, what the fuck are you doing? And he splatters gas on the guy and then whips out a zip ball. He's like, do you really want to do this for your shitty job? He's like, take whatever you want. Right. You know? So, the guys carjack a car from a guy.
Right.
Bodie, he wants to cover up all the sweat patterns, so he just torches their old car.
He knew the sweat patterns were giving them away, the butt prints. That's the only evidence they have, butt prints.
So that gives Johnny enough time to catch up with him.
Right. He jumps to fire to tackle which president was it? Do you remember?
It was Bodie. It was Reagan, yeah.
Oh, it was Reagan. Oh,
of course it was.
Yeah, this scene is amazing. This is not a back lot. This is an actual little, I don't know if they actually built a little station, but this is in a neighborhood or something. It's great. I don't know what was going on in what I assume South LA that you could just, hey, can we set this building on fire? Okay.
Okay. We need more of that in movies today.
Yeah. And the stuntmen must have been terrifying. They're wearing masks as they're on fire and tackling each other into fire.
Yeah. You know,
kudos.
Yeah, no, this scene is actually fucking cool as shit.
I thought it could use some CGI. That's all I'm saying.
What would you have liked to happen in CGI?
Some light flares.
Light flares? Yeah. Maybe some better music.
Yeah. But yeah, Bodie catches fire.
I wanted a cameo drive-by by somebody.
Yeah.
Like Snoop Dogg.
Yeah. I don't like a low rider that's bouncing.
Yeah.
Yeah, that would be.
Oh, shit, that shit's on fire.
You know, that shit's not for shizzle.
There we go. That was still new back then, so that would have gone over like hotcakes.
I don't think that wasn't even invented back.
No. That was in early
2000s. So the guys take off, leave Bodie. So Bodie just starts running, and so we get another chase through these really. It almost brought back images of the Kickboxer episode. None of you guys are listening to, where they're in the ghettos of Brazil with these tiny, narrow, like walkways and shit. And we're going through people's houses. There's a moment where Bodie throws a pit bull at fucking Johnny.
This is supposed to be so zen. He's supposed to be, I hate violence. And he sets gas on fire, throws dogs.
He never does violence. He lets others do violence for him. Mm-hmm. So he sees that pit bull and goes, that's a violent breed.
That's speaking like a cult leader. Right there. Right. I'm not violent. Right. I just whisper.
He hates violence. Mm-hmm.
That's right.
So, yeah, so Johnny just bashes the pit bull away from him. They're chasing, they're running. All of a sudden, they're in the fucking LA reservoirs where we always have to have a shot.
Reservoir drainage. If any movie's based in LA, we see this drainage system here.
Chasing him. And this is where we reach the culmination of our homoeroticism. Because they have to jump down a wall to get
in. It's like
10
feet. The reservoir. It's a good fall.
Yeah. So Johnny he fucks his knee up because he had a bum knee. So he can't run after Bodie. Bodie's just running. He's making his getaway. He has to climb a fence.
Yep. And then, so he's at the peak of the fence, which is like 10 feet up.
Right.
And then he's got the barrier to the drainage system as well. So it's concrete. And he's pulling himself up, but then he stops because his heart takes over.
He's like, my lover's hurt. Like, he feels pain for that. At the same time, Johnny pulls out his gun. Remember, 100% in the rain. 100% on the gun core.
This is why we needed that scene.
And he's got his, he's got it right on, he's aiming right at Bodhi.
That's right. And look, Murray, I've been doing, I've been going through a thing right now. I wish I had insurance because I go get it checked out where my vision is very blurred. So it's like when you rub your eyes a lot and then you have kind of like the foggy kind of images going on. I have that like all the time now. So that's scary.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Life in America, people. Greatest country
hey,
in the world.
Hey, America, number
we're
just, one.
We're, hey, I think, I don't know when this is coming out. I think we just celebrated the birth of the greatest country of all time. We're about to.
Yes, that's right.
So, yeah.
And so one of the things I don't think we've ever possessed is being able to read eyes from, what, maybe half a football field away? That would be 50 yards?
No.
You think that's about how far they are?
Yeah, at least, yeah.
And through a mask? That's hovering over a man's face. It's impressive, is what I'm trying to say. That he can read eyes through this mask, Murray. That's what I'm trying to feed you.
It is. It's worthy of the ending of Bonnie and Clyde. It's very, do you love me as much as I love you? Of course I do. Would you die for me?
Johnny just blows his fucking load. But he can't kill his the object of his load. He just shoots up into the air. Money shot.
Yeah, those bullets could come back down to haunt him, couldn't they?
And Bodhi's like, remember, malignant narcissist. I got him. He's got him. He could have been shot, but Johnny didn't do it.
Is that
exactly? Exactly. Okay. Bodhi knows that Utah is his man, and then my friend Carrie pointed out at this point that every round you fire, you have to write a report on.
Yeah.
So he's going to be doing paperwork for 3 days.
Did, I think you said...
Papas will cover that. Don't worry.
Just give me a couple meatball subs and I'll get this filled out for you. Did, little? I think you said his name was Bobby. Did little Bobby have any kind of comment for this line or this moment?
No, Bobby was sleeping and he didn't watch with us.
Fell asleep. Just like me at the first Transformers movie, just fell asleep for it.
You didn't miss anything. I didn't even see the movie, and I'm saying you didn't miss it.
All right.
All right, so back at HQ, Johnny's got his leg all taped up. They're listening on the radio to see if any get any information about these guys.
Pappas is pissed at Utah because he missed. You can't miss.
No, he told me, I know you don't miss.
Yeah.
What's going on?
Because he thinks...
You're in too deep.
Thank you, Murray. And that leads us into Sum 41.
Did you notice there's a lot of cleaning of Johnny's wound scenes in this movie as well?
Was there?
There was at least two.
Oh, shit, I don't know.
And
remember.
They're the same wounds. Apparently, Tyler is shitty at cleaning wounds because she's just dabbing at his randomly on his face.
I mean, come on. She serves up shrimp and fries for a job, and then she serves the rest of the job.
It's too complicated to just, you know, clean off.
You got a dab. Venture brother joke.
And so she cleans him up, doesn't. He's still all fucked up looking. And then he wants to tell her finally that Bodhi is the love of his life. No, he wants to tell her that he's an FBI agent.
That's
and he's
right.
He's been using her, but he still loves her. It started out as like, I was just going to use you, but now I've developed feelings for you because the studio doesn't want to do gay stuff, so he's got to love this woman.
Right. It's just like how in Commando they wanted to avoid the gay situation, but they also want to get away from the biracial situation. We were supposed to see Arnold really fucking get down on what's her name?
Ray Don Chong.
We were supposed to see them just like fucking get it on hard, but the studios were like, no, we can't show a white man with a biracial woman.
Yeah.
Oh, that sucks.
Yeah,
it does.
We would have. I mean, we got a stunt double in her place, probably, but still.
No,
but I actually thought this is one of the few that again shows that someone bothered to try to write Tyler well because she seems to think that he's drawing away from her because he doesn't want to say he loves her. Remember, she says, why are men so bad at this? And so you get the sense that she knows he's fallen for her and has, you know.
Meanwhile, he's fallen for Bodhi. You know, that's the thing.
That's really, I didn't really think about it that way. That is a really good little fucking twist there.
So now the Brodies have gotten together. They're freaking out because they know like Johnny is a fucking cop or a Fred. Right. And they're like, finally, what people who write Marvel movies can learn from this. A guy actually says, the stakes, because there's actually stakes going on here. He's just like, we got to get the fuck out of here. We got to blow town. And like Bodie's like, no, we can't. I got a plan. I have a master plan. We have to do one last fucking robbery. Yeah,
don't worry about him. I know just what to do with him.
I wish I'd known that your mom worked at a bank, because I would like to know the average amount of money they have in the tills. Are they really making a lot of money doing what they're doing?
No, when I worked at McDonald's, if it was like a rush, I probably shouldn't reveal too much. We had to change that till a lot. It would literally run out of room, and you really didn't want more than like $500 in it.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so like they're not really, but for Bodie, it's the thrill. He doesn't give a shit about the money, so I understand where he's coming from.
Yes,
I don't know why.
And he's sticking it to the man.
Exactly.
That's his whole point. Right. Mm-hmm. It's sticking it to the man.
Because, once again, malignant narcissist. He is a god, and he lives by no man's rules.
Right.
He creates the rules.
I forget what his line was, but he's like, I'm trying to bring humanity back to humans or something.
Which is something some bullshit artist would say. Yeah. It's not that at all.
Right.
But these people are just eating it up with a spoon. They're just like, love it. So he gets these guys under control again. They're like, okay, because they're ready to fucking bug out.
So now that we know that Bodie, knows exactly what to do with Utah, we're like, whoa, what is he going to do?
Because they're all like, kill that motherfucker. Yeah. Like, don't worry, I have a plan.
And so we cut over to Keanu sleeping in bed, and suddenly Tyler knocks down his door.
We just see a bullet hit
a gun.
So we're thinking it's Bodie.
A silhouette of a shadow silhouette of a person holding a gun over Keanu's head.
Yeah, bullet blows up the pillow. It wasn't a Tempur-Pedic.
No.
And we're thinking, oh my god, it's Bodie. No, it's Tyler. She found his badge or something.
I guess she found his badge.
She's figured out somehow.
She throws the badge next to him.
Okay.
So that's what I figured. Obviously, it's supposed to imply that like Tyler tipped Tyler off. Bodie tipped Tyler off that he was an FBI agent, go through his wallet or whatever.
And she's just like, are your parents even dead? No, well, they live in Ohio, so kind of, you know, I mean, might as well be dead. And she just was like, you fucking piece of shit, and just runs off. So, all right. Utah is like, I gotta get my babe back. So he's like constantly calling her.
I saw this in the movie I talked about in the first episode, Once Bitten. There's always a scene in these movies where the boyfriend fucks up, and then he's got a call, and you hear him like reciting the apology, but then it's like, oh no, that he didn't actually call her.
No, he doesn't have the nerve.
Working through the lines and everything. So he's working through the lines. How is he going to apologize?
And just as he's figured out the right way, the right end, he's like, maybe I can say my grandparents are dead. And that fucking,
I misspoke. My grandparents are dead.
Bodie bumps in. Yo, bro! Let's go. We got something to do. Come on with us.
Hey, we got the Steely Dan rocking right now, bro. Can't buy a thrill, but we can.
It's like, Johnny, don't lose that number. He's just riling off.
Ricky.
He's Johnny.
That's so good. And I hate myself that I fucking fell for it.
And then
it.
He's like, we don't want to do dirty work no more. He's just hitting all the Steely Dan greatest hits.
I didn't know this was about to happen.
And this is the greatness of our show, people. None of this is
planned. And now Melly's getting involved.
She loves Steely Dan.
He does. We listen to a lot of Steely Dan at his house.
So,
but I want to thank Griff for clearing up a plot point that I actually got into a frisky little argument over delicious donuts about this morning, of how on earth Tyler finds out and how Bodie lures her, this strong, independent woman who's got her own thing going on. And I like Griff's idea that Bodie probably said, oh yeah, you want to look through his wallet and then like meet me at this car and breathe into this cloth, you know?
No, it could have been a lot of different things. Mm-hmm. She still obviously has some kind of like trust in Bodie. So it makes sense that she would believe him to some degree.
Yeah, yeah.
So I really think that was the leverage he held over her. And also, you know, she's got to be thinking in some way, like, oh, this is too good. Like, this just fell in my lap. This weird dude from Kansas. Enough, Millie. This weird dude from Kansas just happens to fall in my lap. This is a little suit to serendipitous.
Serendipitous, yeah.
Too many fucking, what's it called?
Syllables. So, all right, this is where we get some tension, because I think Johnny is not 100% sure, because remember, the mask stayed on, so he's not 100% sure Bodhi is the ex-president, but he's pretty sure.
Yeah.
Bodhi obviously knows. So he's like sweating, like, are these guys going to fucking kill me? Or are they really going to do some extreme skydiving? So they get on the plane, and then Bodhi's like, well, here's your chute, bro. And obviously you're going to be a little trepidatious because you don't know if the guy's going to kill you. and this makes sense, because this is the kind of mind games that Bodhi would play with somebody. So he's just like, And one of the guys even pipes in, yeah, he's really shitty at packing parachutes, you know. So he's like, and then Bodhi reads the situation. He's like, well, you can have mine, bro. I don't care. And then we get a little, like, parachute shell game kind of thing going on, where everyone's just trading parachutes.
Yes, we thought it was going to be the Princess Bride. Oh, you would poison your own drink and make me drink your drink. And we think that kind of is the mind game going on here. But all the Brodies are like, no, my bag's packed to break your neck, brah. But I'll give it to him, and then he can have yours. And so they're all trading and swapping.
So, like, now we don't know whose is who now.
Right. Millie was barking because the deer came in the backyard. That's why she's upset.
Fucking deer.
So I had to close every window and door. Anyways. And so here we are. We're up here. Everyone's settled in their packs now. And what is the scene for? He knows.
Johnny's like, I got a fucked up knee. I can't be parachuting. Don't worry. Where we're going, you're not landing on land.
Bro, where we're going, you don't need roads. Hang 10. Shrimp, that is. I like toast. Do you like toast, Utah? You toast?
So then we get some pretty cool stunt work. This looked like Patrick Swayze. If it wasn't Patrick Swayze, his stuntman looked a hell of a lot like Patrick
Swayze.
There
was like 9 different skydiving scenes.
Can you imagine how long it took to film this scene? How many times he had to go up and down to, like, get all this shit?
Oh, yeah, that must have been, like, what, 80, 90% of the shoot? I figure they probably had to write all the terrible ADR around. Like, just film everything, and then we'll add, where are you going? And you got in my way.
Yeah, it's not like you can see mouths or anything.
They could have just done what Megaforce did brilliantly, that green screen where they're just, like, hanging.
My God.
Even though we do get a lot of scenes of Keanu just hanging from a crane with a fan blowing up.
So bad.
This is amazing.
Oh, God.
Has anybody here ever skydived?
This is a question for Aabra, basically.
No.
Neither have I. But would you want to? I think I'd be down for it.
Yeah. I know.
Yeah, there is a lot of skydiving here in Oregon. I know a couple skydivers. It's cheap.
Is it?
Yeah, it's surprisingly cheap. I don't understand how the insurance works. I think it's all done privately or something, but yeah. Go skydiving, guys. Yeah, do it.
If we ever wind up in Oregon, all three of us
are going skydiving. I was just
going
to say.
And you know what, Aubrey? I'm packing your shoe. We're packing each other's shoe.
Oh, that's
but
it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But you guys are right. The packing the chute, it's an obvious literal trust exercise, the trading of the packs and letting and I love the idea that you guys caught on. Johnny Utah still wants to believe in some tiny little hope that it isn't Bodhi.
Yeah.
So if he trusts him here and these men trust him, great scene.
He's not just buying in on a person. He's buying in on a whole new philosophy for life. And he's 25.
Almost over, according to that kid at the surf shop.
The kid at the surf shop totally dunked on him. And he's feeling that, like, this whole movie is based on that kid being like, yeah, you're 25. Your life's basically over. He would have been able to think clearly if not for meeting that kid. He would have saw Bodhi for what he was, But he can't think clearly because that kid mocked him for being 25.
That's so fantastic.
He is eat, surf, skydiving now.
Right. And so they do a little thing with the bro moment where they grab each other's hands.
There's literally a line, "Hey, guys, star formation, star formation."
It's beautiful.
It's, I want to say, my favorite line reads of this movie by Keanu were, "Whoa!" and "Ah!"
Say what you will about Keanu. Nobody says "Whoa." Like
nobody.
King of "Whoa."
So we get a little shoot chick in here because everyone's like, "You go, bro." No, you go, because he's still like, maybe I got the fucked up parachute.
Yeah.
So he needs to be like holding on to Bodhi in case his chute doesn't open. But so they're going. It's like they're getting to a point where if you don't pull it, you're gonna fucking die, even with a chute.
Right.
Go that far. But I think, what is it, like Bodhi pulls Johnny's chute? Like his ripcord?
Yeah, he does.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, okay. And guess what? It's like a trust fall. He did it. Another manipulation of a narcissist. He's like, "You can trust me."
Yeah.
And then they all land in the water, which I think, would you want to land in the water? Because you could get caught up in your chute and drown and shit. I don't know. I wouldn't want to do that.
But. Yeah, those chutes are probably fucking enormous. So, yeah,
like, I don't know.
That does seem like it could be dangerous.
Especially with a bum knee. I wouldn't want to do that.
I do want to do that skydiving thing, though.
Dude, we're doing it.
These guys are constantly setting things on fire. So them landing in water is, it's not even in the top 20 of what will kill them.
Yeah, that's a good point.
So now I think, like, Johnny's back in the smog.
Oh, 100%. Yeah. He comes down. "I've never been so alive in my life. Whoa, you pack my pack. I pack your pack. We're going to pack each other's
We're
pack.
We're going to fudge back." You know, it's just, and then he's like, and then Bodhi's like, "Got him again. He's back in my clutches."
"Hey, you've been mentioning pack a lot. I want to show you the Packard Bell in the back of my van." That's a computer reference for everybody. So wish.
Yeah. So. Yeah, what was this? Like, I'm talking about 90s technology.
Yeah, it was like a surveillance set. Okay. It was like a computer hooked up to a little monitor.
So their little van, he's like, "I want to show you something. This might sting a little, but I think you need to see it."
Bro, it's going to sting a little bit, you know, in the pack, but you
just
need
a little
to see
bit
it.
Of insurance.
Yeah, I call it insurance.
So we turn on the TV, and then, oh my God, it's like, is this a Dino Velvet production? I noticed that background. It looks very Dino-esque.
I know. I was just waiting for that music. And, you know, when we first get a glimpse into the video, it's like, I don't even recognize this woman because she's wearing something completely out of character to who it is. Aubrey will go on more about that.
Yeah, she's wearing this like cheap Sears sateen slip, and Matt way too creepily chimed in, "Thank God she's got panties on." And, you know, it's just not her look at all. We've watched this woman strip on the beach. You know, we've watched her running around in Daisy Dukes. Yeah, why this tacky grandma slip?
Mind games, Aubra. Yes. You're absolutely right. That's not something she would wear. That's something Bodhi would want her to wear.
Yes. I love these little moments of surrealism because this really does look like something out of Lost Highway by David Lynch. It's a strange scene. There's something really uncomfortable when he shows himself in the mirror. Remember when Rosie lifts the camera up and films himself?
Yeah. Yes. That
Rosie,
yeah, there's something.
Or is it the machine?
Yeah,
I think
something
the origin of the machine, guys. Because, yeah, this is the fucking hatchet man of the group. He's not involved with the robberies. He just kills people for Bodhi.
Is he part of the family?
Yeah, because he
family.
Kills
people. Family.
Yes.
You said Hatchet Man, so.
So.
Exactly. Charles Manson always kept around one actual alpha male. He really preferred a harem. But he needed that one guy, and that was the guy, read
this
the wiki.
This is his tax.
Exactly.
And so he's just like, "Look, I hate violence, Johnny. I don't, but sometimes... But Rosie, he loves it. And sometimes you got to use violence to get what you want. So I'll just forget everything that happened. All I need is 6 hours." And because Johnny flips out, it's like pinning him to the side. He's like, "Hey, in 6 hours, if I don't meet Rosie, she's a goner."
In person.
Yeah. He will slit her throat. "You got to let me go, Johnny."
He's a dog of war. He doesn't care. He wants to slit her throat. I love Tyler. She's unfortunately, never loved me the way she loves you. Like, she's never gone head first. Like, you know about diving into a sea? You never do it head first.
She dove into you. You do it feet first with a parachute.
That's right. She dove into you head first, dog. She never did that for me.
Yeah.
She's headstrong for you. Keep it on, trap.
So, this is a weird thing he says, because it's like he's telling the truth yet manipulating at the same time. Because
right.
He's like, you're special to her, not me. Once again, building Johnny
building him up.
But also telling, being honest with himself. Like, that stings. That, like we
exactly.
said, Tyler's
it's
not his
called,
possession.
What's it called? Narcissistic rage.
Yeah,
when they ever find out the truth about something and they just lose it and go on Truth Social and I'm going to stop talking now.
Right. And so, yeah, who knew that this dumbass movie, only we could pull this out of this movie. These layers.
I'm pretty sure in the top half, 8 days ago, we asked the question, why would they even try to remake the movie? This is why. You know, it's so fucking deep and yet so stupid at the same time.
Right. There's a fine
it
line
is.
Between genius and stupid. All right. So the boys, because the Brodies are like, let's just get the fuck out of here. And he's like, no, we need some cash to, you know, fund our, next move.
Right.
We're robbing a bank. Like, what? Like, we got to be in Santa Monica for the plane. He's like, we're going to do one more hit. And then we're done. And they're like, but once again, the hubris of a narcissist. He's like, I can get away with anything I want.
So we all load up into that same van that they loaded Johnny up into to show him the tape. Everybody's in here now. We're all riding down to Santa Monica, and we're preparing for the robbery. Everyone's getting their fucking suits on that they dress in to do their robberies. And
Nixon is getting thank you on his ass, like, put on.
Oh, yeah. Of course he is, which is even crazier to think that they do it on the road, because you right. do not see. I saw Henry Rollins get a smiley face, give Johnny, or not Johnny, but Steve-O a tattoo on the road.
Yeah.
That's a hard thing to do.
Yeah.
You can't write on the road.
Let's imagine if they were on Michigan Rollins, it'd be even worse.
Wow.
All right. So, Bodie hands Johnny a shotgun, but he makes sure to unload it. He's like, cause you're gonna do this with us, Johnny.
Right. And he's telling him, you know, you're going to be involved with this.
You're over, man. Give up. What are you doing? It's over. And he's just like, I can make my own laws.
That's right.
Like, he's totally in delusion mode now. He's just like,
too many.
I am the master of all I see.
Brody is.
Yeah.
Bodie is.
Bodie. Be the servant of law when you can be the master? Master.
Also, we're all out of masks.
Yeah, because remember, there's only four masks. They didn't have the Gerald Ford mask.
They didn't have. You mentioned that at the top half. You didn't think it was going to come back, everybody.
Right. And why? Because they, in Bodie's mind, and this wouldn't work at all. He's like, we're going to frame you. Like, you can't take us down because you're going to go down with us.
I want to agree with you there that it's too obvious, but no. No, the way police work, they just like, shut and close case right there. They got him. He's the guy without the mask on. We got him. He's behind it all. He's smart. He's FBI. He went to that's Johnny Utah. He's a quarterback. Of course he would design all the plays for the robberies. So they would pin this all on Johnny. I think they're right.
So they, and he also explains, and it's true, that you can control people through fear. He's like, I've never had to shoot anyone at a bank robbery, because all you need is the fear of shooting somebody to get what we want. Because he's like, I don't want to kill anybody.
Right.
You know?
And they do everything so fast, like people don't really have a chance to really think about
it. And when you're scared, you just freeze up.
Exactly.
So,
I got in a terrible car accident. I probably should be dead right now. And what did I do as soon as I got in the accident? I froze up. And I just stared at a semi nearly fucking run me over. That's what happens in these life and death situations. You just freeze up.
So
brain don't know what to do.
So they show up at the Santa Monica Bank, do their regular moves. Everything's going smoothly until...
LBJ, head to the vault.
What? We never do that. We're doing it now.
This was a great moment for everybody, because everybody reacts to it. And they played it up well. everybody reacts. The vault.
I'm glad that Aabra pointed out the thing about narcissistic rage, because this is him getting his like power back.
Yes.
Like, he's just like, because he for a glimpse, he saw his real self, and he doesn't want, he's in love with the Bodhi character. His real name is probably like Franklin or some nerd name, you know.
You know it.
And, right. Like, yeah. And he's just like, he doesn't like what he saw, so he's got to get his power back. So he's like, I'm going to do the ultimate bank robbery. I'm going to do something I've never done before. And the guys, they don't like it, but they're in the smog too. So they go with it.
I mean, they also know enough that these robberies only work when you have one person. It's like in basketball, where you got to have one ball handler. And they're one ball handler. You can take two meanings from that as well. One ball handler.
he's running the point break, if you will.
I'm sorry, Aabra. That's sports talk. Yeah. But yeah, he's running the point break here. So, of course, you have to listen because you have to go along. You have to be coordinated and everything. And it's showing. So everyone's trying to get coordinated. They're trying to find the person with the vault. Was it a key or a password they were looking for?
Something like that. Some key to the vault or something.
Yeah. And so
you usually require two people, like two keys to open these. Yeah.
That's right. We got the inside scoop. It's like the fucking nuclear missiles. You got two keys. Right. And so, yeah. All right. And so we're starting to get the keys worked out and figured out and everything. And we have people calling out, 65 seconds, we're at 65. We already know in 25 seconds they should be fucking gone.
Right.
And they're still trying to figure out where the keys are at. Two keys? Two?
Meanwhile, there happens to be a cop on his day off, had to deposit his paycheck.
This could have been the aforementioned Matt Hannon in this scene here.
Right. Well, they wouldn't have got away if it was fucking.
They would have stopped and been like, "Is that rock star hair I see before me?
Or is it a wig? I don't know. It depends on which point of the movie.
That's what scene is."
So he goes to the like limp dick security guard that's there to collect a paycheck, let alone deposit one.
Right.
And he's like, "Hey, I'm a cop. I'm a cop. Don't do anything. I'll suck your dick." He's like, "No, I'm a cop. I got a gun. Let's fucking fuck these guys up. And cover me.
Rent-A-Cop's like, fuck no, I want to go home today. And I got to agree with Rent-A-Cop here. I don't want to get fucking shot doing the stupid job.
Unfortunately, he falls in the cocksmog of real cop. Hero cop.
Hero
Martin
cop.
Martin Riggs.
Hero cop.
So he jumps up, freeze, asshole! And just starts shooting at people. Shoots fucking Reagan. We're like, oh my God, are they going to kill Bodhi?
Yeah.
There's just like a free for all. Everyone's shooting everywhere. One, I think it was Jimmy Carter gets shot in the neck, so he goes down.
I didn't keep track. Do you know?
I think it was LBJ. Yeah, it's pretty nasty, actually.
It's a gruesome scene, and all that 60s fog that's rolling in here because it's an old bank and everything. It's ridiculous.
So Hero Cop gets shot. He shoots at fucking Johnny's like, I'm a fucking cop. And he just starts shooting at him.
Yeah, Johnny gets shot a couple times in the chest.
Right.
Apparently, they didn't have a mask, but they had a bulletproof
vest.
Well,
we didn't know that at the time. Because he never showed them put bulletproof vests on. So we're like, what the fuck's going on? Hero Cop gets shot. Rent-A-Cop gets shot. And then we're like, okay, movie's over with. Everybody got shot. And then we get the moment. Like Johnny jumps up and he's like, he's really selling it.
He did a good job. Well, again, what is an but a whoa without the W. So it's like, of course, that's the line that, you know, Keanu could read well.
And then he rips open the shirt and we see he's got the fucking bulletproof vest on. Right. So does Bodhi. But unfortunately, LBJ got shot in the throat. So he's dying.
So Bodhi has got, of course, you know, he's. Wait, does Bodhi go over his boy and, like, you know, caress his head and everything?
Yeah, you point out in the notes, and you're right. Bodhi shoots the cop, but he regrets it because he doesn't want to kill people.
Yeah.
So he is kind of fucked up by that.
Aubrey, did you see that too? Did he regret
it? Yeah, that's exactly how I read it. Yeah, that Bodhi obviously did not want to actually engage in the violence. Earlier when he stopped one of his fellow men, they were going to shoot Johnny in the first one, and he knocked his gun out with his gun. Yeah, he obviously doesn't really want to do it.
Right.
So I agree with that, yeah.
Right.
So Bodhi's holding LBJ. Like, come on, you're going to get out of this. He's dead, bro! You caused this! And then fucking, they have to leave because then like Nixon comes out with the money from the vault. He's like, we got to get the fuck out of here. He's right. Dead. Let's go.
We're already way beyond 90 seconds at this point, too.
Right. So Bodhi takes off. Before he does, he gives a nice fucking hit over the head with his gun on Johnny, knocks Johnny out.
We come to FBI are in all over this bank, and of course they're cuffing Johnny Utah.
Right, they got it right on the tape. That's he was right. Involved in the, even though he screamed, "I'm a cop," don't you know?
Yeah,
all yeah. This shit.
Well, maybe they didn't have audio on these cameras or yeah, something. That's true, I don't know, but you can clearly see he's not doing any, but he is brandishing a weapon.
Right, and Harp, Mr. By the Book, never felt his gut ever in his life because why? Probiotics. It just goes right through him. He never felt anything in his gut. When you just live on a diet of meatball sandwiches, it's all gut feelings.
The only thing Hart feels is the swelling biceps.
He feels a swole.
Yeah. He's swole as fuck.
So he's like, you were behind it all along. I can't believe you infiltrated the FBI, Utah. Good going. You fooled all of us. Pappas, no, he didn't do it. What are you talking about? He's like, at least let me bring him in. Don't let these fucking black and whites bring him in.
We found that out on like Chips or something about the black and whites. I'd never heard black and whites you before haven't? Until Chips. Really? And now that's all I hear is black and whites.
Yeah, it's a thing. Yeah.
Yeah.
And so let me let him bring him in, bro. And he's like, I should have known working with you, you sloppy old fat fuck. That me, you would corrupt this guy.
Meatball gurgling. Sloppy ass surfwear. Fuck.
He's like, fucking flex your biceps. Ugh, I can't. You know,
I can't even lift my arm that high.
I got this injury. I can't. I thought so.
I got meatball elbow.
Meatball elbow.
and that's all he can stand, and he can't stand no more. So he fucking... He punches out Harp.
That's right.
He's like, respect your elders. And it's like, grabs Johnny, gets in the car, and then Johnny's like, they're heading to Santa Monica airstrip. We can still stop them. He's like, I know. I believe in you, bro. Pulls out the fucking handcuff keys. We're going to do this. So they head down to Santa Monica airstrip.
Is this movie just running long at this point?
Of course it's running long.
How should we have ended this movie at this
It should
this
have
point?
Ended in the bank robbery somehow. They should have finished it with that.
Absolutely. That's what it feels like, that there's a whole other edit that they worked in figuring it would be cut short where maybe Bodhi dies or something. But no, let's just add on.
But remember, guys, we got to rescue Tyler. I know we've all forgotten about her, much like these guys, because they're so in love with each other.
Yeah.
They forgot the icky girl. But she's still out there. And she's 6 hours. Fucking Rosie, he's gonna slice her up.
Yeah,
it'll make a great Dino Velvet movie, but you know we're kind of invested in Tyler at this time.
We're kind of invested in Tyler.
If you can say we're invested in any character, it's probably Tyler.
At this point, especially the way we edited our episode, people are gonna be like, "Wait, Tyler? Who's Tyler? I thought this Steven was Tyler, just a bromance type, you know, lovers quarrel type situation." Like, what if Bonnie and Clyde were on the opposite sides of the law?
So, Bodhi and the boys are loading up their like, $500 they made. Well, they robbed the vault, so they probably got some money.
And the ink packages, probably, too.
Yeah, that's probably all ruined, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know, when did they start putting ink? You would know this, you have the inside scoop on banks.
Yeah, they tend to put them in those bags when they demand the money, but if you're just emptying the cash drawer into your own bag, obviously it'd be very hard to work an ink packet in. Yeah, I don't know when they introduced those. Good stuff.
You're gonna have to call your mom.
So next tippy tap, we're gonna have a call with your mom.
Yes.
We're going to get the inside. We're going to get her
in on the parachuting, too. It's going to be all.
Oh, shit, yeah. We're going to do the whole fucking podcast parachuting.
Right. We're going to do the star thing.
That's going to be awful with the wind noise and everything.
Like, so, record it as we jump. Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's all you'll hear the whole time. All right.
So it's like Utah's like he puts his gun down. He's still in love with Bodhi. He doesn't want him to die. He wants to bring him in.
Right. I don't know if you mentioned it, but Johnny tells Pappas, we can't shoot or arrest them.
Right, because did he mention because of Tyler, or is it just that? I mean, that's the reason why, but did he mention Tyler?
I don't remember.
Okay, doesn't matter.
Let's believe it's implied he explains it.
Let's believe it's implied. We have to, because he doesn't really care about
it. So Pappas is hiding behind some luggage or some shit. Johnny puts his gun down.
Oh, yeah, he walks out. I'm unarmed, bruh. I'm unarmed. Speaking surf to y'all. Meatball sandwich. Surf wax. Cabana.
Cordova, surf wax.
Oh, Cordova. Excuse me.
So while he's trying to talk Bodhi down, Roach? I didn't remember
it
any of
it. Wasn't Roach, but it was like Austin?
It says Roach here. I didn't remember any
Roach
of
Roach was in another
Yeah,
place.
They're okay. So generic.
Yeah. The one was named Kromit, I remember. I don't remember who he was.
So Krombom is standing behind Brody, Bodhi, and he's got the bag of money, but it also has a shotgun in it. But he doesn't want to show the shotgun. So he cocks the shotgun with the bag to show, like, hey, we're not agreeing to your rules here, bro.
Meanwhile, the pilot's hearing all of this, and it's like, I'm getting the fuck out of here. They're like, get back in there. Fucking
get back in the fucking plane and do your fucking job. And Keanu has to reveal, Johnny Utah has to reveal, hey, I got a gun on you, bro. Where? Where's Roach? He had to take it too. You know Roach.
Upper Decker. He's hilarious. Upper Decker. They're still like finding fun, even after all this tension.
They're fucking...
So Roach is coming out, zipping his pants up, sees Pappas right in front of him, shoots Pappas. Pappas spins around, shoots Roach. There's a shootout. Everyone's shooting everywhere. The pilot's like, can I get out of here? Like, no, you're still flying us. And so now...
Shit, we got Roach dead. We got Pappas dying. We got the people loading up on the planes, but the plane hasn't taken off yet.
Kromit gets shot. He's in the plane, right?
Who's Kromit?
I don't know if that's his name, but I know one of them was named Kromit.
Okay.
But do you guys think they had to have the pilot under duress fly it? Because you think, since this film involves so much, flying photography, maybe like a PR person was going over this and said, I don't like that the pilot's evil. Can you make it clear that the pilot's a good guy?
Wow, that would be interesting if they were like, hey, pilots are always, they're Switzerland pilots.
Judging by how like extreme with 3Xs Bodhi is, I would have assumed he would have been a pilot. So I was kind of surprised.
Yeah, but then they wouldn't have been able to have like a conversation that. So I kind of get it, because they also have parachutes. So he would have been able to kill him and jump.
You're right, yeah.
Pilots must be really hard to write, because, yeah, this guy's got to be part of a crime, but what, it was just booked through a private jet company? It's like, oh, I've got a gig out to Santa Monica. Oh, and now I'm being kidnapped, you know?
Right, and do you like, add in, oh, yeah, we got your wife and kids under duress or whatever.
Oh, my God, has Bodhi got, like, multiple kidnaps going on all over Santa Monica?
Rosie's twin brother is holding the family hostage.
There we go. I mean...
It's, you know, once again, layers to this movie.
His
name's Rosie Roosevelt, another president. Is that his president name?
Oh, that's a good call.
Nice.
That's really good. But so
this is all Cameron's input, by the way. Oh, James Cameron is just putting these little peppering these in there.
This is why movies can't be good anymore. These people just used to do quaaludes and fucking write movies all day and rework them constantly. Right. And that's why we had gold. And that's why movie theaters are dying nowadays. It's all studios.
Don't worry, AI will fix it all.
Yeah, it's all studios working along AI and being like, when do we have the Hulk bust through the Warner Brothers logo to save Iron Man? It's fucking awful.
I'm calling him Kromit, the guy that's in the plane. He got shot.
Okay, let's just make it very clear. How many people are loaded onto the plane here? Because Bodhi tells...
we also got to point out, I can't believe we forgot, the heart and soul of the movie, Pappas, runs towards Johnny and gets blasted multiple times in the back.
Oh, I thought we did this.
By the guy that he shot. So he gets killed.
Okay.
No!
Okay. So let's do a fucking, what do they call it? Ticket check or whatever the fuck. So we got Papa's dead.
Yes.
Roach dead.
Yes. Roach has been clipped.
We've
yes.
got a guy you're calling Grombe.
Yes. Look it up. Look it up. And I don't know if that's him, but look it up in the fucking okay. Credits. So, right next to Violent Naked Woman. It's Grombe.
So we got two dead, and then we have alive people on the plane. Pilot. Hostage. Pilot. We have Grombe.
Grommet has been shot.
And then we have Bodhi getting on the plane. And then Bodhi tells Utah, you have to get on the plane with right. me. You're riding this to the end with me.
Right.
So that's it.
Yeah, that's it.
We have four people on the plane.
Three people that are not dying, one person is. So.
Aubrey, that sounds right?
Yes, that's good.
Okay.
This is, we always talk about the timelines. This is a lot happening in 6 hours from the parachute scene to this.
You're they, right.
Remember, this... Rosie's going to kill her.
You're right.
Well, then again, Johnny thinks Rosie's going to kill her. We don't know what Bodhi told Rosie.
Yes,
so,
this is true.
Okay.
But
yes, Bodhi is doing your madman doctrine. You don't know what he's going to do.
Yeah. Good doctrine to pull.
So they take off to head to Mexico, where you always, when you're a criminal, you always head down to Mexico.
You got
to
think about all of this shit, though, in the...
Because he's going to fly like the wind.
The microwave timing that's happening here is
go
all I wanted to say.
Go down to Mexico and I'll fly.
What if they got a crosswind and they couldn't get there in time? And it's just like, oops, sorry.
No, like we said, this is just mind games by Bowie. Yeah, there is no timetable.
Right.
Yeah,
Rosie's probably just hanging out with her.
Right.
They're probably
well, yeah, he is because
shit.
We see later on. You know?
Like, why did you guys take me out here? I'm dressed in my grandma nightie. Yes.
So they're flying, and then they okay, they what Bodhi tells the pilot to fly higher, and he's and then
lower.
No, because
so they start low.
No. I'll explain.
Okay.
Because he goes. Go higher, and then Grommet, I'm calling him Grommet, says, but they're going to pick us up on the radar if we go higher. He's like, bro, I have to be high enough so you can safely jump.
Right.
So that's why they got to go higher.
There was a line as they got on the plane where Utah says to Bodhi, you can't escape. Haven't you ever heard of radar?
So that's why they go. So. You know, but he's like, because he's, and once again, he's probably, most again, master manipulator. I care about you, Grommet. All he cares about is the money that Grommet has.
Exactly. Carrie and I got into this whole, I'm like, why didn't they leave him in the tarmac? And Carrie, who's smarter and better than me, she goes, duh, he's the money bag. He's basically using his body as ballast. And I went, oh.
Right.
That's good.
So,
he's going full, like the mask has been revealed. He's full narcissist manipulator at this point. And he's just trying to get away with this and start anew in Mexico.
You, me, Aubrey, and Tyler saw through his mask. Everyone else is in the fucking fog.
That's right. And Carrie, apparently.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
Carrie's brilliant. Pilot.
So they reach their coordinates where they're supposed to meet Rosie. And like, Grom is like, I feel cold, so cold. That's your blood draining from your body, bro. You're dead. And like, fucking Bodhi's feeling, he's seeing all his plans unravel. He's getting a little rattled. Puts the money on Grommet, tosses him out. Don't worry. It's the last you see of Grommet, so you'll never hear that word again.
All I can think about is McDonald's every time you say Grommet.
Why?
Isn't that one of
That's
the...
Grimace.
What's
By the way, everyone, get your Grimace shake. You can drink the blood of Grimace. That's what the flavor is of a Grimace shake, apparently. So he's like, see you later, asshole. And Grommet, you know, Grommet once again, in the smog. All you just need a little sweet talking from Bodhi.
Wallace and Gromit.
Yes.
There it is.
Claymation characters.
Okay.
The whimsical claymation characters.
Yes.
So he goes off.
Now, so after everybody has jumped, Johnny's got to jump after Bodhi, who jumps.
Well, yeah,
first.
Bodhi's like, he's ready to leave Johnny alive.
Yeah.
He's gonna...
I forget what this whole conversation. I already remember what this whole conversation was because I don't remember. There's a good buildup here before.
Yeah,
because
you're thinking,
Bodhi
why
jumps.
Does fucking Johnny have to be on this plane at all? If he's
yeah, well, first
leave.
Of all, we're skipping the greatest line ever. I know
oh,
you
yeah,
want
no.
me so bad. It's like acid in your mouth. Like, holy shit.
I mean, I've heard that line back in that Beatles song, I Want You So Bad, like acid in my mouth.
Are we sure it's acid in his mouth or some other bodily fluid? I'm just saying. Adios, bro!
Do you want a cauldron for that one?
But yeah, again, the ultimate, you know, what do you call that? The trust fall exercise that Bodhi has set up the situation that Johnny has only one choice.
Right. It's through him. Everything's through him.
Yes.
It's like we've learned, because we haven't done this in a while. Maybe we'll have to do this in the upcoming month. We haven't talked to Jesus in a while. And we know Jesus is a bridge, but we're learning that Bodhi is a bridge. Is Bodhi Jesus?
He thinks he is.
Yes.
Bozus.
Okay, we're so close to the ending, guys.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. No, we're getting there.
So he jumps.
It's already 4 a.m. here. Don't giggle with us.
He jumps. And, like, Johnny's like, I got to get him, bro. So he just grabs a gun and just dives without a parachute.
It's the best way to do it.
Yes. Ultimate leap of faith. He grabs a big fucking gun, jumps out without a parachute.
All right, everybody. Johnny has parachuted one time 7 hours ago.
Correct.
In his life. He has figured out how to make his body, like, move towards objects.
We've all seen movies. We know how to do this.
Yeah, just put your hands to your sides. That's right. Go.
Squirrel suit when you need to direct yourself, or you go, if you need to go fast, you get tight and aerodynamic.
So he catches up to Bodhi, grabs onto him, puts the gun to his head. Shoot! He's like, I'm not gonna pull shit.
Aabra said it best in her notes. Bodhi, who's very zen, doesn't have any situational awareness. Doesn't realize there's somebody closing in on him.
Well, no, because if you're a narcissist, you don't. People are objects. They're not human beings. You know.
How do you feel about that?
Yeah, that's pretty good. Like that, he's done. He's either done with Johnny, or there's this greater plan where he wanted Johnny to jump after him, which is ridiculous. But yeah, I like that idea that he uses people and he's done with them.
I mean, in the world we're living
but
in today,
and this is why he doesn't want to kill people, because this is another narcissistic trait. You always want to keep people around,
yeah,
because you always might need somebody in the future.
And I like this where you said that. I feel like in the end it comes into his plan. Oh, Johnny, no, I meant for you to live. That was my plan. It's never been my plan to kill. It's always been my plan that you live throughout these states where it's like you're sure to die.
Mind games.
That's like what our conspiracy theories all do today. Oh, no, that was actually supposed to happen that way, and that leads to this now.
Right. So he's playing chicken with Johnny. He's like, no, you pull the chute. Drop your gun. You're going to have to drop the gun, and you're going to have to pull the chute. Both dying.
You already told me, bro. I'm going in. I killed the cop. So what do I care? My life's over. You're 25. What do you got to live for? Tyler's out there wearing her white cotton P-word.
Stupid.
So
ugly negligee, yeah.
So fucking Johnny blinks. Fuck! Drops the gun, pulls the cord, because they're at the point. They're the point of no return.
That was the whole tussle, by the way.
Yeah,
he's got a gun in one hand and his other hand securing a hold on the man who's gonna not let him fall to his death. So Bodhi's telling him, "You gotta let the gun to pull the cord." So Johnny finally lets go of the gun to pull the cord.
Right. Very at the last second. So they do land, but it's a rough landing, and even Bodhi's like, damn, you are one radical son of a bitch. Johnny fucks up his knee again. Constantly fucking that knee up.
Yeah. Bad at selling it, too. He's got to work on that.
Rosie shows up in a Jeep with Tyler. They just, once again, this mind games. He's like, you can have this broad. I don't even want her. Take her.
Right. Bodhi gets in. See you in the next life, Johnny.
Takes off. They drive by the body of Gromit, grab the money.
Bone just sticking out of his body. He's miserable.
Yeah, they do add some ADR where it sounds like Bodhi is saying, let's get him, and Rosie saying, don't leave him. But you don't know if that's a little game they're playing, and Rosie knows perfectly well he doesn't give a shit about this now dead guy.
That's good. Bring out.
So, and I also Cameron, think another Cameron reason why they in. Flew above the radar is because I think Bodhi wanted, because they're in the middle of the fucking desert in Mexico. So he wanted Johnny to be found.
Yeah.
You know, because they would have died, you know.
Jesus Christ, he wants to have like this super spy type
cat
James
and mouse
Bond
fucking game.
Yeah, no, he wants to be Carmen Sandiego, and he wants Johnny to be chasing him. So he's gonna go get himself a nice red coat in Mexico with the fucking sweet.
All right, guys, movie's over with, right? I mean, the bad guy gets away, I guess. What happens? Sometimes.
We've already had this is a modern wrestling match. We've already had three false finishes. We're going way past. We had the hot tag already. Let's fucking end this movie. Oh, wait. We need to do a fast forward now. 1 year later?
Well, we got to have the payoff.
Yeah.
Babyface got to get his payoff.
It's been, I'm looking, checking my watch. It's been 50 years since the last great storm.
Oh,
and it's
okay.
Happening in Australia, the land down under. And so we see, we know we're in Australia because Johnny's playing a car radio. It's like, hey, right, mate, there's a fucking storm coming through this fucking place. And Johnny, you know, and time has passed because Johnny's hair's a little longer, a little scruffier.
Oh, shit, we haven't done a temperature check forever. Especially not this episode. Who are we craving right now? We've only got two characters left. Tyler's written off. Are you with Craze for the Sways, or are you Slaves for the Reeves?
You know me. I shaved this morning, Griff. I'm with Swayze because he's got his hair is cut, got rid of those awful blonde highlights. He's looking good. He's clean shaven.
It's true. He's got this nice, neat look, and he's shaved, yeah. And yeah, he looks good.
Mm-hmm.
Johnny looking like a schlub.
The roles have been reversed.
Yes, exactly. He's Puka shell necklace, all that shit.
Yeah, he's supposed to be the FBI agent, and we see Utah coming in here.
Finally, all gut now, Griff. All gut.
Right? Okay.
Yeah.
I'm all over the Swayze.
So he goes up to the beach. Guy's like, get the fuck out of here, mate. It's a fucking storm of the century.
Don't you see the raindrop blend storm of the century?
And he's like, oh, no. And he sees one guy who has the balls to stay on that beach. And he knows who that man is.
I want to give Aabra her moment here because she was very upset with this scene. Because apparently she recognizes this beach, Murray.
Okay. We're not upset. It's not Australia.
What?
I like you said that in your accent. What?
You know what? Yeah, you'll be shocked by the terrible accents of the locals and the presence of fir trees. This is Wheeler, Oregon.
But it makes a good fucking Australia.
It makes a good Australia.
And this storm is a blowing. And Bodie's just staring off into space. He's getting collected. He's ready to go out there. And Johnny throws down the Reagan mask in front of him. It's over, bro. I'm taking you in. And Bodie's like, come on, man. You know, because like, I know you'd never miss this storm of the century, bro. And it's just like, and then he throws all the fucking Bodie shit in his face. He's like, how many people died because of your fucking greed? Because of your manipulation?
This is the only like leverage he has over him because he knew Bodie didn't want to kill anybody. And so that was his in. That's how he cut to his core immediately because he's had.
He has no core, Griff. He's an empty shell.
It's true, but still, Utah sees something in him.
He wants to see something in him. He's still in that fucking storm.
I 100% believe he still wants to see something in him. And I think if... Look, Aabra, you're going to have to get down on us because now we're really philosophizing.
No, you guys are doing an interesting... There's an amazing scene in a book about the Green River Killer where the lead cop, who's been chasing him for, I think, 20 years, is just begging him to prove he has any humanity. Oh. And he ends up just like walking out of the room after the guy's like, I don't know, I just killed people, whatever. And the cop's like, you know what, you just made my day.
Wow, what'd you say that was called?
Oh, it's a book about the Green River Killer. I'll send it to you guys.
Okay,
it's really good. It's written by the son of the cop, so there's some little kind of cute bias that he obviously writes his father. He's a very nice guy. Yeah. It's a good book. Yeah.
Was that cop Dirty Harry? Because you said he made his day.
Yeah, he's basically, really, he does. He says something like, you know what, you made my goddamn day. Because the idea is he's been sitting there for hours trying to get through to this guy, because they've made a deal with him that if he just confesses to this, this, and this, they won't execute him. And so the guy has to sit in a room with him. It's just an awful listening to him, you know, outline all his crimes, and yeah, there's no humanity.
That's the thing. Yeah, you want to believe there's some, like we don't want to believe that there are people that are just fucking monsters out there, you know, and there just are. You got to accept that. And he doesn't want to believe that. So Bodie's just like, looks at him, looks up and down. He's like, you've been surfing?
Yeah.
And he's just like, every day, bro.
So this is what I was trying to say. Like, Bodie, or Utah still wants to see, he knows that Bodie was, he believes Bodie was right, if not for killing those few people. If Bodie repents a little bit here, I think Utah's like, that's your exit right over there. Walk. Just walk. And then they're going to find each other in 5 years surfing. Right. That's what I believe is Utah's dream ending to this.
Yeah, he wants to keep that going, the cat and mouse.
Right. He's ahead of the other FBI or police or whoever's coming after him for this reason alone. He wants to give Bodie the chance to confess to him and him alone.
Maybe just to tell him he loves him. I don't know.
Oh, my God. If this were fucking, you know, a bromance movie, that's definitely the moment. With all the rain pouring down, the giant waves, I don't need a 50-foot tidal wave. I've got a...
Oh, yeah, that rain machine is working its ass off. It's just ridiculous.
You just tsunamied my heart.
You did? There we go. I'm glad. Aubrey, you did such a good job of buying Murray that 3 seconds he needed to come up with. You just tsunamied my heart.
Fantastic.
Would that
tsunami
be
my heart.
Time to go, bro. You're not getting what you want. And then Bodie's like, fuck this. Let's fight. So there's another fight scene. Back and forth. We see those little pirouettes. I pointed it out in Roadhouse. It's a dancer doing martial arts. So a lot of pirouettes.
Yeah.
A lot of tippy tapping, if you will. And then he fucking gets Johnny pinned. They're on the beach. So he's pinning Johnny underwater.
Johnny bought into commercialism and is wearing the puka shells. So he's got an easy handle on his head.
Right.
You know, he's just holding him by the
drowning
puka shells.
Him. But Bodie can't do it. He can't kill this guy either.
Right.
There is a love here.
Right.
It's a twisted love, but it's a love.
Right.
And then he goes, like, let him go. And then he looks down and then fucking handcuff. Hands tied. And so we see, you know, he's like, you're coming with me, bro. And he's just like, now we see a chopper come in and we see cops coming out with fucking machine guns and everything. I'm sure Jack Belair could tell us what every fucking kind of gun they had.
That's right.
But we're already in hour number 12, so we're going to go on. And he's just like, Bodie's like, come on, bro, come on.
You got me surrounded every corner. I'm not going to get away. Out there, I'd be I'm death on a stick out there. Just let me get out there and die the way I want to die. And I believe in this kind of thing. So get the fuck out there. Die your death.
Yeah.
Yes, and this is heart-wrenching. This is heart-wrenching because Utah loves Bodie, and he wants him to be alive, even in a cage. But Bodie can't be caged, man.
That's right.
Yeah.
He can't be caged. He obviously did a horrible thing, so it's like Johnny's going to be conflicted by that his whole entire life. So you got to let it go. You got to let it go.
Yeah, my friend Carrie said, you can't put baby in a corner, and you can't put Bodie in a jail cell.
Young Bobby did not wake up for the conclusion of this movie.
Bobby slept late. I think Bobby's been partying for graduation or something.
I need you to have Bobby watch the conclusion of this movie. I want Bobby's interpretation as well. See how it fares up with us.
Yeah. I'll get Bobby some homework. Okay.
We're all adults here. Come on. We need the kids' interpretation of it.
So,
true.
That's big on YouTube.
Bodie starts paddling out. Gonna hit that wave. Cops, what the fuck, man? You let him go.
Wait, what are these?
Holy fucking koala balls. What the fuck? And he's just like, he's just staring out there. And then we see a gigantic wave just consume Bodie. He's toast. He's gone. Wipe out. And then we see, we can't, it's, I'm sure because of the rain, we can't see it, but I think there's some tears running down that face.
100%.
Johnny. And Johnny grabs his fucking badge and just hurls it into the ocean.
Don't need this anymore.
Walks
bro.
Off, ready for Point Break 2. where he becomes the Bodhi character.
I believe
and
that.
Corrupts another young hotshot played by who was young and hot in like 92.
Jean-Claude.
No. It's gotta be like a pretty boy young actor. You know your Abaddon. Pretty boy young actors, Aabra. Who would be the perfect Johnny for his Bodhi?
Jonathan Taylor Thomas.
That's
too young.
Yeah, probably too young.
Yeah, who'd be in the wheelhouse at this point? Like a Corey Haim, some kind of Corey Haim could actually act.
Okay,
River Phoenix, right there. Is he still alive at this point? Alive at this point?
Joaquin, is he doing anything? I don't know. But yeah. No, you want River because he was the pretty.
River would have been great. I mean, he'd bring some demons.
Kind of feminine, kind of looking. Dude. Yeah, like you said, it's that androgynous dyke look.
Yes, and he would see totally himself is. In him. And of course, River Phoenix character would have been a football player,
right?
Or maybe it would have been a different sport. So they
Soccer.
Disagree on that.
Yeah.
Oh my God,
football? They would argue about what's the real football.
See,
they just write themselves, people.
If people,
all we can do is think about what could have been because we lost River Phoenix. We can't have it.
And
we lost Patrick Swayze.
And we lost the sequel to this movie that they were apparently going to make and never did.
Yeah. Instead, they made a shitty reboot like 25 years later.
That's right.
Oh my God, you did it, Aabra.
Woo! You get to be on twice in 1 week.
Yeah, that's pretty amazing.
Wow. Any final thoughts about this movie that we maybe forgot to bring up?
No, you guys did a great job. We went on some, you know, so I didn't expect to get so much into serial killer diverse, you know, ideas. That was a
well. That's not a we. That's an us.
Yeah.
We all, y'all.
We all did it.
We all got there.
Teamwork makes the dream more.
Makes the pipe swell.
So I'm everyone's going to be clamoring for more Aabra after this. I'm sure sometime down the line we're going to say because people cannot stop talking about the Tippy Tap crossover challenge, the first ever starring our boy Jack Baudelaire and Phil DeGlass. By the way, you notice all our. We got a lot of guests that use fake names. Yet anybody who's using fake names, it's you and I because of the shit we say. Because we've ruined our lives, we can never get a real job now. But yeah, I think that's going to be the next Aabra appearance. We're going to get you. We're going to get Matford head to head.
I would love if that's the next one, but I believe it was either early in this episode that came out Wednesday, or before we started recording that we came up with like. A few different things we need to talk to Aabra about. So we might roll.
There's many layers.
It was rollerblade-based movies in the dystopian future.
Yeah.
And we've already done one.
I don't know. I think.
Watch the trailer. It is shot beautifully. One thing I want to say real fast about this film, the only thing we didn't touch on, this film is freaking gorgeous. Peterman, the DP, they must have had to get up at 3 or 4 in the morning to shoot every scene. You wonder if that's part of the insanity of the film. Because everything has that glowing magic hour light.
Yeah, they got a lot. I mean, it's cool to see these movies where they actually get a lot of exteriors. These shots are really cool, and they do get some good city shots,
This has always been my beef with 90s. A little too slick for me, the look.
Yeah.
But, hey, it's the 90s. And Catherine Bigelow proved even women can make shitty action movies. It's not just a man's game, people.
That is the ultimate equality.
Yeah.
Wait, what was her part in this?
She was the director.
She was the director? Yes. Amazing. That's a good job. She knew how to shoot a
former wife, one of the former wives of James Cameron.
One of the many former wives. Yeah, she had hooked up with Cameron while he was deciding what to do with, I can't remember her name, Linda Hamilton. And there was a first wife in there, too, and a couple others.
Yeah. So
yeah.
Well, we gotta end this. We got a big outro here because all right, thank you. We love you, Aabra. We're gonna have you back on.
Oh okay. Yeah. So soon. Definitely for the Rollerblade future. I want that so bad.
It was a treat. This was a lot of fun. You helped strengthen a friendship that really should have been. You know, this was great. Thank you.
Hell,
oh my God, we're just uniting so many people. I love this.
All we want
you
is
are
people.
The positivity of this show. The ultimate message is it's about friendship.
Thank you,
because everyone thinks we're so negative, and I'm like, the fuck we are.
I've watched so many people cover the movies we do, and it's like, hey, this is stupid, right? No, it's like fucking so much effort and time went in this movie. That's why we put effort and time into these movies. Right. Oh, thank you.
It's getting that time of year, people. July's coming. And you know what happens in July? It's Griffmas in July, where I hand the reins over to my baby boy, Griff. Let him take over. I take a long summer's nap for a month where he programs the show. He decides what goes on this show. I just sit back and let him take charge. So, Griff, what is the first movie for second annual Griffmas in July?
That is right. You 100% do everything else throughout the year. Griffmas in July starting last year is the first time I took the reins over this show. Reigns, see? Christmas.
Yeah.
I got wordplay for days. And so this year, I've got a few different ideas hopping around. We've played on a lot of new themes.
I don't know. I'm going to be as surprised as you guys are.
Yeah, Murray is privy to one movie only by whispers, though. Like, we haven't said a title to each other yet. Yes. But
I don't know the title. Yeah, but I know what you're going
to. And no one else will either. So I have to be very specific with this title, which is very interesting because a character who comes up in Twin Peaks season 3, I believe, is one of the top billed characters in the movie. The guy who played Truman's brother, Harry Truman. I forget his name.
Robert Forster.
Robert Forster is in this movie, and you're probably going
through. He's a good actor.
Your Rolodex, like, oh, Robert Forster. Griff's got us on a hot streak here. We're starting with a Robert Forster.
Right. We're gonna do Alligator. We can do Alligator.
Oh my God, Alligator's so fucking good. No, I'm sorry, we're not doing Alligator. We do have something right off Necropoflix in this month, and I can't wait because it's a sexual thriller.
Oh my God.
That got added to my Rolodex back in what? When did we do that month? Was it February or March or
what? Sex thriller month?
Yeah,
that was like April or May.
That was April?
I think it was April.
What is time? No, everybody, we're starting out with a little movie that I found and told Murray about many years ago.
Yeah.
I'm so excited. I found this on cable, one of those like free movies you could get through the on-demand service, and I was like, oh my God, you got to see this movie. It was when we were talking about Legion of Steel.
Yeah.
With each other a lot.
Legion of Iron, I believe.
Legion of Iron.
I always get it crossed up.
Right. And so thank the fucking maker. We had to buy that one on VHS and watch it over at Murray's house, which is not a problem. It's just funny that was the length we had to go to see it.
Yeah.
One of the movies I might have to buy on Laserdisc. And we'll have to buy a Laserdisc system so we can watch it because I really want to cover
it. What is this movie?
The movie we're covering next week, 1990. Don't look at the George Clooney version of the movie. That's not the one we want. We want 1990s The Peacemaker. Okay. Two aliens crash to Earth, have to learn our ways. One of them bad, one of them good. One of them happens on a lonely woman who just wants to fuck.
If that doesn't make you want to listen, I don't know what will. So we'll see you next Christmas.
Christmas
in July is in a full effect. Keep it warm, y'all.